Okay, welcome everybody. My talk today will be about responsive web design. And I think I had the most controversial title of the event. Basically saying that anyone who embraces responsive web design is stupid. My name is Rick van Westrenen. I'm e-business consultant at UI in the Netherlands. And I will try to convince you today that responsive web design is stupid. And at the end of this talk, you will probably agree with me. So, what is responsive web design? You probably know what it is and why everyone is doing it. In 2013, it was something that all agencies tried to sell to their customers. In 2014, the customer is expecting it to be in the total package when you build a website. However, it is a nicely technique to get your website in order on all screens, basically for every device, but it is like out-of-date milk. Out-of-date milk looks white, but when you screw up the cap and you pour, you try to pour it in your glass, you get those blobs in your glass and it smells funny. I've done it multiple times. But anyway, responsive web design is basic part of redesigning any project. So what is it exactly? Basically, it is nothing more than making the content of your website appear in a smaller screen, which is technically very smart. Responsive web design alters the presentation format to the screen. This is handled by some logic that dictates the overall size and format of the content of your website. It sometimes even removes content or hides content. It changes your navigation structure. You know, those hamburger menus. But responsive web design doesn't look at the device you use, not at the characteristics or the capabilities of the device. It just looks at the screen size. Even further, it doesn't help the customer when they are on the website. Even it makes it more difficult for the customer because he needs to relearn the navigation, because it can change completely. So why do you want to make websites accessible on any mobile device? But the only thing what responsive web design does is make it readable. But it does not look at the characteristics of a device, the functionality of a device. It only looks at screen size. But why do we want to have content of a website accessible on a mobile device? Well, that's very easy. 78% of all European people has a mobile device. They access something on mobile. 41% has a broadband connection. And a broadband connection, that's something between 3.6 megabits per second to 50 megabits per second. So basically, they have a normal internet connection, and most of the times, even faster than at home. Globally, website traffic on mobile devices grew almost with 10% in the last 12 months. Globally. In Europe, 25%. And the 25% was not on tablets, it was on smartphones. The biggest growth was on smartphones. The smallest, well, iPhone 6 Plus is not the smallest, but basically the smallest size. So we have to think, what is the default screen where we are on today and in the future? Will it still be the desktop? Or will it be the smartphone? So, for whom are you building your website?
Is it for the device? Is it for the screen? Or is it for the customer? It's an easy one, I think. Who thinks it's for the screen? Oh, I already get you on agreeing on my title. It's the customer, of course. You build your website for the customer and not the screen. And responsive web design is making your content readable on any screen size. That's not for the customer, that's for the screen size. Responsive web design is basically nothing other than a cheap suit. So when you go to a store and you, or online, you order a suit and you just type in your dimensions and say, well, I'm 190, I'm slim, I won't fit in a standard suit. I have to go to a tailor to do all kind of stuff. Normally I have to buy a smaller suit and they make it longer. I don't know how, but they make it longer. So when I dress up in the store, I have trousers ending something like here. And then the guy who's selling it to me said, well, that's okay, we can make it longer for you, there's no problem. And I think, oh, well, my God, I hope in the end I get the right suit. But basically, this is responsive web design. You get something like a one-size-fits-all. And if you have the most optimal smartphone, the most optimal iPad or tablet or whatever, then it will look nice. But if you have something in between, then it won't look, no, it will look like something like this. You have to keep in mind that responsive web design looks only at the presentation side of your website, not at business logic or the content side. And that's something that makes gives room to other kind of design concepts. Another design concept is adaptive web design. And I think that some of you already have heard about adaptive web design. It's a term that was defined by Aaron Gustafson. He wrote a book that was called Adaptive Web Design. And he described it as interfaces that adapt themselves to the capabilities of a device, both in form and function. So responsive design is only in form, the screen size, and adaptive web design is form and function. It looks at what is the device where my website will be on, capable of. So what can we do more than just fitting to the screen? For instance, we can use the GPS, or we can use the camera, the capabilities of the device. And then you get something like Google. Google search uses adaptive web design. This is on the desktop. I'm going to order pizza bestellen in Dutch. They don't understand me if I talk English. But when I try to order it on my smartphone, the same query, pizza bestellen, it knows I'm on a smartphone. It says call. And if I press on that, then I can directly call this specific pizza delivery guy and order a pizza. So, adaptive web design. It scales. You see, the design is a bit different, but I have the same content. I even have those advertising at the top. You don't see it, but it's on top. I have the map, but I have extra functionality. Calling, the direction, how to get there. So it adapts to the capabilities of my device. But does this embrace the customer? I told you, we have the device, the screen, or the customer, and the customer is the most important. So does responsive web design and adaptive web design embrace the customer? Well, basically, responsive web design and adaptive web design are simply tricks, technical tricks, some kind of technical logic built in your website, does something with the device you're holding, nothing more. It does not embrace the customer. You hope that it embraces the customer, but it only looks at the device, not the one holding the device. wouldn't it be great if your website looked at the situation where you're in? Because when I'm holding the smartphone, I could be sitting in my car in a traffic jam. That's normal in the Netherlands. We only have traffic jams. We don't have highways. We have traffic jams. I could be sitting at home because all my email is coming into my smartphone. And when I'm behind my laptop, then I have those different accounts. So that's easy for me to check all my email in one place. It's on my smartphone. Or I could be at the office or at a client or in a train, for instance. Those are different situations where I have a different need. So we have to look, in my opinion, to look at the context, the situation, the emotions, functionality, the form, device. But it's not, that's more than a trick. I get back to Google again. Last year I was in France on holiday, and France has a very good broadband mobile connection, normally. Somehow we ended up in a small village. My wife had rented an apartment, and there they had, I think, a 2G or a very slow connection. And I couldn't get my email, so I thought, well, let's go on my mobile to webmail, to the browser, and check if I can have connection to my Gmail account. Normally I get this, the rich HTML5 interface. But now Google noticed that I had a slow connection. They noticed that I had a certain situation where I wasn't able to get this. I didn't get a sorry connection timeout. No, I got this, the basic HTML version. So Google noticed that I was on a slow connection and gave me an alternative, because Google thought, we provide our customers with only one thing. That's basically a platform to check your email. They think, well, Google is very good at thinking, they think about the customer. They want to embrace the customer. And just by giving me access to my email, they don't care about the interface. They say, well, our basics for Gmail, of Google Mail, is providing email. So they gave me, on a slow connection, they gave me the basic HTML version. They looked at my customer need. So the screen size is important, of course, because it makes it readable. But I don't care if it's readable, but I don't get the content because I am on a slow connection. I want to have access, I want to have the content, the stuff I need at that moment. So then we get a combination of behavior, form, function. You know, form, responsive web design, form and function, adaptive web design, and behavior plus form plus function equals situational web design. That looks at what the customer needs at that specific time. So we like all those short terms, you know, the RVD and AWD and SWD. Responsive web design, design based on screen size to make it readable. Adaptive web design based on the capabilities of devices and focus on the user experience. And situational web design based on the capabilities of devices and the situation of the user to focus on the content provided. That's basically the difference. And then you think, so what? I have a customer, they want to have a website that's accessible on a mobile, and they don't have enough money. That's in the Netherlands also, they don't have money because, well, going Dutch is the term. Responsive web design is easy, it's cheap. You just take Bootstrap or Foundation, you have a simple framework, and it just fits on your website. It just works. in all browsers, on all devices, and you only have to define which breaking points do I need, 3, 4, 5, 6, whatever. It provides the user with the right content on the device. But why? Why shouldn't you want to go with responsive web design? And why should you want to go with a situation that you take the context of the user in consideration? Because you want to earn money with your website. You want to have conversion. When you tune your message on your website more to the user, the user will be more engaged, and an engaged customer will buy more, will respond more, will stay on your website longer. And if you just make a website that fits on the screen, but you have to scroll or swipe for ages to get a telephone number, that doesn't work. Not when you are in a traffic jam and basically you're driving and stopping and driving and stopping. That won't work. I tried it. So it all comes down to conversion. So if I state that to embrace responsive web design is stupid, then basically I tell you, if you want to do responsive web design, go ahead, but don't count on the fact that you will make money. You will make money, but you can earn more money. Just look at the context of your user. So then you think, okay, Rick, you are telling a nice story, but do you have proof? No. Well, I don't have proof. I never have proof, but I have statistics. There are interesting statistics that state that households with a tablet, and then I think, well, not an Android, but an iPad then, that they will spend 20% more than the regular desktop user household. 20% more. That's an interesting fact. ...84% use their mobile in-store. So they walk in the shop and they walk with their smartphone and they compare prices, they're reading product reviews. Is this the right product? And what are other people saying? Or even social media, they're using social media, social reviews. Is this product, do you recommend this product, my dear social friend? And it's amazing, we don't do anything with that information. But if you know where your user is, because the smartphone uses GPS, you know where he's browsing, maybe you're connected to Facebook, and Facebook has a lot of data about what we are doing, where we do it, and with whom. Why don't you use that information to give them specific information at that specific context, that specific situation, when they go to your website? Well, here's some proof that's not on situational web design, but that's another example. There was a research about augmented reality. You know what augmented reality is, right? Last year on the conference, there was a presentation about augmented reality and Type 3. It was found that sales increased with 30% when augmented reality was used to present products. 30%. It's not like it's 5%. With this percentage, everyone wants to use augmented reality. So just listening to the customer need, look into what they want, and provide something based on that context, on the functionality they have, will increase sales. But how do we get there? There's a nice talk about situational web design, responsive, and etc. But how do we get there? Because we are not capable yet to get into the head of your customer, literally, just to know what you all are thinking. But that's needed. We need to know what your user is thinking in certain situations. What do I need when I am in a traffic jam and I am late for an appointment and I want to contact that organization where I'm going to, that I will be late? At that moment, I need a telephone number. So when I go to the website, the first thing I need is a large button, call us. But when I'm sitting at home and I'm just on my smartphone and I think tomorrow I have an appointment, then I don't want that big button, call us, in the center of my screen. I just want to read, oh, what's this company about and who is the person? Is there a photo of the person I am meeting, et cetera, LinkedIn connections, you know. Other information is needed. And the difference, there's a technical difference between the two. In a traffic jam, I'm sort of moving. I'm on a mobile network. And when I'm sitting at home, I am on a Wi-Fi network, and I'm not moving. So there is a technical difference, and I can see that there is that technical difference, and I can change my website accordingly. But just defining those situations, that means that you need to define the journey. Does everyone ever has been to Africa, by the way? Just a question. I've never been there. Anyway, you need to define your user journey. So what are people doing when they go to your website? And what is their situation? What do they expect? What's their context? And can we provide a different experience to the user in those specific journeys? And you write them down. Yes, you have those personas. But next, after defining those personas, you go into the user journeys. And you focus on context, progression, devices, functionality, and emotion, and a lot of other things. Just check what you can expect of those users. You can even do some quality research, invite those users and ask them, what do you want to do with our website when you are in our store? Just ask. And if you define those user journeys, then you are able to tune into the minds of the users, the visitors of your website. And you can develop a website that's focused on delivering the right content at the right situation. And that's important, the right content at the right situation. It's not showing all content on a smaller screen. Making it readable, responsive web design. That's the R for readable. We don't know which kind of device people are on. So how do we expect that people on every device will want to have all information that's on my website? But I am not the one deciding that I won't show you all content. So basically, we have a problem. We have a few problems. We have the privacy problem. That's another problem. I won't go in privacy because I think everyone has a right on privacy, but we don't have any privacy anymore. So that problem will solve itself. The problem is that we have standard framework like Bootstrap and Foundation. And those are just easy, standardized technical tricks, and they just show all content in one small screen. Out of the box, it works, but out of the box, it's not a solution that we need. So, one very wise person, Rasmus, wrote this quote, I think a year ago or something, or maybe 1.5 years ago. That's basically that made me thinking about this concept of situational web design, that preview is not only about devices. And that's also one of the bases of Type 3 NEOS. That's also the reason why I'm here talking, Type 3 NEOS, Type 3. Within Type 3 NEOS, you have the possibility to do previews basically based on user journeys. You define situations and you define the screen size, the capabilities, whatever you want to show. An agency can do that. If I'm wrong, I will be corrected. That's a great thing to be here. So in NEOS, you can easily switch between those views, those user journeys for your customer. An editor can do that. If you use responsive web design and only think about screen size, you can define that certain content won't be visible, like your menu. Your large menu will be a hamburger menu. But I, as an editor, have no influence on how things are changing, which content will be removed, or the order of things. I cannot define where my third block of content will be on a smartphone or on a tablet or on a desktop. That's something that a developer decided for me. But that's not what my user, the visitor of my website, wants. They expect me as an editor, content editor, that I provide the content they expect on that specific situation. And then we get a really challenging future. Because now we only have smartphones, we have tablets, we have phablets, we have Google Glass, we have Apple Watch, we have laptops, we have, well, too many things, devices already to sum up. And the end is not visible yet. So how are we able to use responsive web design in the future? We don't know what kind of devices will come to us. How do I define breaking points? Do I have to define 100 breakpoints to make it visible on an Apple Watch and then on Google Glass and then on my Beamer? I don't know. It's impossible. We don't know which devices people will do or will use in the future to read and access data, access content. So I think that responsive web design is nearing its expiry date. Well, it's probably dead already, but it's easy and cheap to use because you have a framework and you know that it works. So you can tell your customer, we can build your website in 20 hours, 16 hours, I don't know. It's a framework, so it's easy. We buy a template at ThemeForest, and we build a website. It's accessible, it's readable. So I think we have to build the best customer experience possible. And that cannot be done with responsible web design. It can only be done when you look into the context of what the user, where the user is, in which situation he is. Thanks.